Welcome to worship. As always, we trust that as we meet one another, we also meet with the Lord as we worship him. You should have an announcement sheet in your pew. I want to draw attention to one or two things that are either there or not there. First of all, the Presbyterian Herald is available out here in the link, so please pick up your copy. Then the Coleraine Community Choir is having its first outing on Friday after lockdown, and they're having a concert of Easter praise, and that is at 8 o'clock in First Coleraine. And the offering is going to the Ukraine Crisis Appeal. So I'm sure they would appreciate your support on this, their first concert after lockdown. Then next Sunday, we, Sunday School, are having an outreach event between 3 o'clock and 4 next Sunday afternoon. And we would encourage you to bring your grandchildren or your neighbour's children. Just encourage it. It's a family event for all the family, and we would love to see some new people there. You should have a bookmark along with your announcements. The Presbytery has initiated a Back to Church campaign, and they're asking you to pray about that. They're targeting Easter Sunday, and then later in the year, the Queen's Jubilee. And it's an initiative to try and get people out of their pyjamas and off the couch and back into the church building. So please do pray about that, and we hope participate in it. Finally, we've had a wonderful response to the moderator's appeal for Ukraine, and £3,535 has been raised, which is a wonderful effort, and I'm sure will be a great help to those in need. So thank you all very much for your generosity. Yes, come on up to the choir, girls. I need company here. Thank you very much. We would like more choir members to join us, wouldn't we, ladies? It would just give a better lead to the singing, so thank you. As we come to worship God, some words from Scripture. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. We worship God in our first praise, all creatures of our God and King.
Thank you.
welcome Morris back to the organ. It's lovely to hear you again, Morris. And also to tell you that from tomorrow, all COVID restrictions are being lifted from our churches. So next Sunday, you come to church, it will be like church as normal. If you want to still wear a mask, that is fine. And we will have a designated area for those who want to keep a metre or 2 metres apart. But for everyone else, it's back to normal. And we're very, very thankful for that. We join our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. We praise you, our God, the omnipotent Father, whose heart pities and whose hand guides those who love you. Before we bow in awe and adoration, to you, our Father, we give our love as children. To you, our Creator, we offer our reverence as creatures. And to you, our Lord, we owe obedience as servants. We pray that you will receive our humble duty and praise through Christ our Lord. Heavenly Father, like the prodigal son of old, we come to you with a confession on our lips. We have sinned, O God. We have sinned many times and in many ways. We have been self-seeking, envious, and greedy. We have fallen short in our duties to you and to our neighbours. But since we know that your pity and patience are infinite, we dare to ask for pardon. Lord, have mercy upon us and forgive us. We thank you, our Father, for the promise that when we truly confess, you freely pardon, and we rejoice in that. Merciful Father, you sent your Son to be our teacher. We have much to learn. Help us by listening to the teaching of Jesus to discover the truth, and by studying his life to gain a revelation of your heart. Lord Jesus, we remember how you said, love your enemies, and how you healed the sick and helped the needy. Teach us, O Lord, to be concerned for those in trouble and be ready to answer every cry for help. Lord Jesus, we remember how you said, do not store up for yourself treasure on earth, and how you were content to be poor. Teach us to repress our greed for money and possessions. Heavenly Father, as we learn to know you better, may we grow to love you more. We ask this through Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to say and to pray, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Well, boys and girls, I want to take you back years and years and years and years to when I was a little girl. Now, we didn't have iPads and we didn't have computer games. Indeed, we only got a TV when I was about 8 or 9. So when we were small, we just had to make our own fun, do our own thing. And one of the things we did, I'm going to tell you about, I just read recently 10 things you must do before you grow up. And one of them was make mud pies. That's something that we did. Have we got a picture of our... To make a mud pie is very, very easy, really. You just find some soil from the garden or a field or somewhere. You put it in a dish, you loosen it up a wee bit, then you add water and it becomes a bit more like a paste. So you could be making a brownie or a chocolate bun, but it's not. But you mix all of this up and then you put it, you could put it in a cake tin or you could put it in a bun tin. Now that is actually a disposable bun tray, so don't use your mommy's best ones because she might not like it. And then the fun begins decorating. You can decorate with flowers or maybe nice coloured pebbles, or I once had a cousin and there was a lime pit near her and we iced them with lime. It was great. It's amazing the wonderful mud pies you can make. And then you set them out in the sun because, like many people my age, it seemed to be always sunny when we were small and when we were playing, and you baked them in the sun and you had a lovely little mud cake. Now the one thing you didn't do with your mud cake was eat it. You just enjoyed looking at them and making them and serving them maybe to your dolls or somebody like that. Now, I'm going to read a Bible story later on to the older people. And in it we have a story where Jesus mixed his saliva with mud and he put it on the eyes of a man who had been born blind. So this poor man had never seen in his life, he'd never ever seen anything of the world around him, and Jesus mixed the spit and the mud. That maybe seems a bit not very appealing to you, but he put it in the man's eyes, told him to go and wash in the pool of Siloam, and do you know what happened? The man could see. We've got a picture of him there, he is smiling and looking so happy. Imagine if you had never ever seen anything in your life and then suddenly you could see again. You would be so thankful to the person who did it. Well, I was thinking, if Jesus can restore sight to a blind man with a little bit of mud, what can he not do for you and me this morning, whatever our problems are? Thankfully, we can all see. But I know whether we're big or small, we have problems, don't we? We worries about school, worries about our friends, worries about our family, just worries we can't even explain. And one thing we need to know is that just as Jesus could help this man, he can help us. It's always so important to pray and ask him to walk with us to school. It's always good to pray and ask him to help us when we're worried. And it's always good to give thanks and praise him for all the times that he does good. I want you to remember that you need to make a mud pie before you grow up. Don't eat it, but make a mud pie. It's great, great fun. And when you're doing that, think about what Jesus did with mud. How healing that was, and how he can heal and help each of us every day if we ask him. We're going to give him thanks today because we don't thank the Lord often enough. And our next hymn says, "Thank you, Jesus, for loving me."
Thank you, Lord.
our scripture reading, we turn to John's Gospel, chapter 9. The Gospel according to John and chapter 9. Let us hear the word of God. As Jesus went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" "Neither this man nor his parents sinned," said Jesus, "but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. As long as it is day, we must do the work of him who sent me. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Having said this, he spat on the ground, made some mud with the saliva, and put it on the man's eyes. "Go," he told him, "wash in the pool of Siloam." This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, "Isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg?" Some claimed that he was. Others said, "No, he only looks like him." But he himself insisted, "I am the man." "How then were your eyes opened?" they demanded. He replied, "The man they called Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash, so I went and washed, and then I could see." "Where is this man?" they asked him. "I don't know," he said. They brought to the Pharisees the man who had been born blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. "He put mud on my eyes," the man replied, "and I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others asked, "How can a sinner do such miraculous signs?" So they were divided. Finally, they turned again to the blind man. "What have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened." The man replied, "He is a prophet." The Jews still did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. "Is this your son?" they asked. "Is this the one who you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see?" "We know he is our son," the parents answered, "and we know he was born blind. But how he can now see, or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself." His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jews. For already the Jews had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Christ would be put out of the synagogue. That was why his parents said, "He's of age, ask him." A second time they summoned the man who had been blind. "Give glory to God," they said. "We know this man is a sinner." He replied, "Whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. But one thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." Then they asked him, "What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes?" He answered, "I've told you already and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too?" Then they hurled insults at him and said, "You are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from." The man answered, "Now that is remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly man who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing." To this they replied, "You were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us?" And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out, and when he found him, he said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" "Who is he, sir?" the man asked. "Tell me so that I may believe in him." Jesus said, "You have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you." Then the man said, "Lord, I believe." And he worshipped him. Jesus said, "For judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who will become blind." Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, "What? Are we blind too?" Jesus said, "If you were blind, you would not be guilty of your sin. But now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains." And there at the end of the chapter, and we give thanks to God for his word. We again join together in prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, we are so thankful for your love towards us. So often, Lord, we can't believe that anyone loves us. We feel our mistakes so strongly. We feel rejected. We are lonely, afraid, and angry. Thank you, Lord, for your love. A love so strong that it can reach even me. Help us, O God, to lead lives of faith. You have promised to shine on our path and to lighten our burdens when we forsake all other things and follow you. Help us to follow in confidence, in joy and in peace, trusting in your mercy and your grace and your care. We pray today, O God, for all those who live in darkness rather than the light. Show them through our lives and our witness that there is a new hope, and that the darkness around them can be overcome, and that they are forgiven when they believe in your Son. Bless those, we pray, who go forth in your name to bring light to the world. Anoint those who work in missions abroad, and grant, we pray, that all our Presbyterian churches' missionaries may be kept safe from danger and see lives changed through faith in Christ. We pray for those who dwell in sadness and despair this day. Bless those who are suffering in body, mind, or spirit, and fulfill their needs as they and we call upon you. And we especially remember before you those who we name in the silence of our hearts, in the silence of this gathering of your people. Lord, hear all our prayers. We pray for our own witness here in this part of your church. Guide us very clearly in the way ahead, that we may walk in your ways and not in the ways of our own desires. Help us to seek your face and to seek your will for our congregation, that we might bring men and women to you and bring glory to your name in all we do. We pray for all the young people under our care. Do not want them to leave this church without a saving knowledge of you. And may it be so for them all. So bless those who teach Sunday school and Bible class, those who are preparing to lead youth club, and all who support in other ways. Finally, Father, help all those who feel weighed down by their efforts to care for the world, who long to see peace between nations and between individuals, who seek the way of reconciliation and love. Our hearts are heavy when we think of Ukraine. We see so many lives lost needlessly, and people displaced, and nobody seems to want to do anything to help. Father, give courage to world leaders and to global organisations to intervene and stop the death and the destruction. We pray that we may see your will done on earth as we work and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We again sing together, lovely German hymn, Fairest Lord Jesus. Travelling along a dual carriageway or a motorway, and you get behind one of those slow coaches and they start to get on your nerves a wee bit. So you look in your rear mirror, you look in your wing mirror, and you start to pull out when suddenly a loud horn blares in your ear and you're startled because there's a car almost alongside you. He was in your blind spot. You should have looked over your shoulder as well as in the mirrors. Blind spots can be dangerous, and not just on the road. This past week, the Queen was accused of having a blind spot over her son, Prince Andrew. She's his mother, she loves him, and she doesn't believe his faults. I'm sure any mother here this morning would not fault her. Mothers tend to have blind spots about their children. We all have blind spots in our lives. Our most numerous blind spots are about ourselves. We're not always aware of our own shortcomings, It's much easier to see other people. I suppose it is because we're observing other people. But we tend to be blind to our own faults. There's none so blind as those who will not see, goes the adage. And this is true too. We don't see what we don't want to see. The gospel story today is about blind spots. We've the story of the man who is literally blind. He cannot see. But this story is about a number of other blind people. Although they can see, they're still blind. I don't think anybody in all of history ever got into as much trouble for doing good as Jesus. Every time he helps someone, he just meets difficulty after difficulty, and this miracle is no different. Here we have a man born blind from birth. He's never seen the sky, the sun, the moon, the stars. He's never seen flowers or trees. He's never seen another human being. And Jesus gives this man his sight. This miracle is unique in all the Gospels because it's of someone with a congenital defect. There's no other case in Jesus' miracles of someone born with a handicap who is cured later. So this should have amazed and astounded the onlookers. It should have provoked a response of great rejoicing, much happiness, great praise. But instead it started nothing but trouble and controversy. The disciples, they decided to start a theological discussion. Why is this man like this? Was he a sinner? Or maybe his parents were the ones who sinned? Now, they were right to assume that suffering was a result of sin, but they were wrong to assume the person themselves were the sinful one or those closest to them. You know that one of the best ways to avoid a living faith, a relationship with Jesus, is to get obsessed with theology and doctrine. These things are necessary, they're of great value. But if they hinder us from seeing who Jesus is, if they hinder us from an understanding of a relationship with God, then they're not good. The poet Steve Turner wrote a very interesting poem about how to hide Jesus. I'll read it to you. There are people after Jesus. They have seen the signs. Quick, let's hide him. Let's think. Carpenter, fisherman's friend, disturber of religious comfort. Let's award him a degree in theology. Purple cassock and a position of respect. They'll never think of looking there. Let's think, his dialect may betray him. His tongue is of the masses. Let's teach him Latin and 17th century English. They'll never think of listening in. Let's think, humble, man of sorrows, nowhere to lay his head. We'll build a house for him, somewhere away from the poor. We'll fill it with brass and silence. It's sure to throw them off. There are people after Jesus. Quick, let's hide him. One of the places we can hide Jesus is in theology. The disciples came with their theological question, and Jesus gave an answer that highlighted their blind spot. He said, there's a more important question than where this blindness came from, and it is this: what is this blindness going to lead to? He says, stop treating this blind man as a theological case. Treat him as a person. Don't look at suffering as something to debate, but something to do something about. Stop questioning and start acting. He even warns that the opportunity to act might not always be there. But he does answer the disciples. He says, this has been allowed so that the work of God may be revealed. It's a simple but a profound answer. But he said, let's get up and go and do something about this. Jesus saw individuals. He saw individuals in need, and always he reached out to help them. And we as his disciples are called to do the same. All of us are called to reach out to help someone in need. Maybe we can't do miracles like Jesus, but maybe what we do for someone else will be a miracle for them. Next person involved in this story is the blind man. We don't even know his name. His concern wasn't intellectual or theological, but practical. He was blind and he wanted to see. He had the simplest attitude of all because his need was greatest. And Jesus did this extraordinary thing. He spat. Now, I believe in times gone by, people didn't spit on cuts or burns to ease the pain or bring healing. Spit can be used to hurt or heal, because later in John's Gospel we read that Jesus was spat upon, but that was to hurt and to insult him. But when Jesus used spit, it was to heal. It must have been wonderful for that blind man to have felt the power of Jesus' healing. After applying the mud of the spittle, Jesus asks the man to go to the pool of Siloam, 3/4 of a mile away. You know, I was thinking to myself, he had to walk 3/4 of a mile with mud in his eyes. How did he see? And then I remembered he was blind anyway. Why did Jesus send him there? Well, this tested the man's faith. Did he really believe he would be healed? Was he prepared to go along with this? But also it allowed him to participate in his healing. Jesus always calls for an active faith, not a passive one. He expects us to pick up our mat and walk. We're meant to be co-workers with him. We're meant to do our part with him in the world. There's another group involved in this drama, the neighbours. What will the neighbours say? Isn't that an often quoted question? Well, they're excited but sceptical. Isn't this him? No, it's his brother, but it looks like him. And so they debated among themselves. No doubt this man looked different. Maybe his eyes had been closed and now they were open. If someone who wears glasses stops wearing them, they look different. So this man probably looked different, and the neighbours are questioning. It's not the man. And he says, well, I am the man. You've seen me sitting here begging often enough. You know it's me. The neighbours were amazed. And then immediately lost interest in the man. They decided they would move on for a bit more new excitement. We must go and see the man who did this. So they switched from the blind man who could now see to whoever had done this. For them it was a passing sensation. They marveled for a while, and then something else happened to take their interest. The Pharisees are the next group, and they're interested in scruples. Scruples are good servants, but bad masters. They're too great dangers in the Christian religion. On the one hand, there are those who have no scruples, no standards. As long as I believe in Jesus, it doesn't matter how I live. On the other hand, there are those with many scruples. You mustn't do this, and you can't do that, and in the end, it's a long list of rules. The Pharisees had a long list of commandments of what you could not do on the Sabbath. One of them was making ointment. Jesus had just made ointment. He'd manufactured something, albeit with spit and mud. And then he'd opened up a clinic on the Sabbath. He healed a blind man. That could easily have waited until the next day. These Pharisees had the closed mind of an over-scrupulous religion. When they looked at Jesus, all they could see was a Sabbath breaker. They missed the miracle, they missed the joy, they missed who was among them. They were trapped in their own narrow logic, their blind spot, and they didn't see. In their unbelief, the Pharisees sent for the parents of the blind man. They admitted, yes, this is our son. Yes, he was born blind. But they weren't saying any more. Don't ask us, ask him. He's old enough to speak for himself. Don't seem like very loving, supportive parents, do they? But they were full of fear. And fear makes you do silly things. Fear says, I'm not getting involved. I'm keeping out of it. Don't ask me. They were afraid of being expelled from the synagogue. They knew what happened to people who followed this prophet Jesus. You know, in the whole of this long chapter, with all those people involved, there is not one word about the blind man's feelings. Not one. The Pharisees grill him again. Tell us. Glorify God, tell us that this man who healed you is a sinner. And the man replied with very, very simple words, but a very powerful truth. I don't know anything. All I know is that once I was blind and now I can see. That's it. He could have added, unlike the rest of you, this man cared enough about me to heal me. But we're told they hurled insults at him. Can you see how ridiculous this has become? A man is healed, his blindness is taken from him, and chaos. What chaos? What blind people? No care, no compassion, and a riot because a blind man received his sight. But there is a happy ending. The blind man was thrown out of the synagogue by the Pharisees and others in authority. If he had met Jesus in the street, he wouldn't have known him. He didn't see Jesus after all. But Jesus knew him. Jesus knew him. The blind man could have searched all Jerusalem for this wonderful person who had given him sight. But he didn't need to. Jesus was waiting outside for him. No matter how many friendships or relationships you lose because of Jesus, Jesus himself is there waiting for you. You know, you're better with Jesus. Better on your own with Jesus than with all the friends and acquaintances you can find. Jesus found this man and surely was concerned about something deeper than physical health. The man had his physical health again, but there was his spiritual health to consider. And Jesus asked him a direct question. We would probably be told this is not a good evangelism tool nowadays. Jesus said, "Do you believe in the Son of Man?" The man replied, "I don't know him, so I don't know who he is to believe." And Jesus gently replied, "You're talking to him now." And we're told the man said, "I believe," and fell down and worshipped him. You may have perfect physical health, but until you've said, "I believe," and knelt before Jesus, you're not healthy. You're not whole. Jesus said he came so that everyone who is blind could see. That covers every person on earth, because everyone is born spiritually blind. Jesus said, "I came to bring light," but he also said he came into the world to judge, to separate people. Light can have a double effect. It enables some to see, but it can blind others. Just think, you're driving along a dark road at night. You put your full beam on. You see better. You can see where a bend in the road is coming. But if you're coming in the opposite direction, that full beam will blind you. If you're traveling with Jesus, you'll see. He is the light of the world, and you don't walk in darkness. But if you're traveling against Jesus, you're blinded. You won't see. The Pharisees heard Jesus saying this, and they said, "Are you saying we can't see?" And Jesus replied, "No, I'm not saying that. Because if you couldn't see, you wouldn't be to blame. But you claim to know God. You teach other people. You claim you can see. So you're not in the category of those who can't see. You're in the category of those who won't see." It's worse to be someone who won't see than someone who can't see. This chapter begins and ends with the same question. Who was guilty for this blindness? At the beginning of the chapter, Jesus said, "Neither the man nor his parents." At the end of the chapter, he says to the Pharisees, "You are guilty for your blindness because you have closed your eyes to the truth." There were lots of blind people in this story. The disciples' blind spot was questions and theology. The neighbor's blind spot was just nosiness and sensationalism. The parents' blind spot was fear. The Pharisees were rigorous rule makers. They lived by their laws and were blinded by them. The man was born blind. But he met Jesus. Jesus touched him. He was healed and he believed. What do you think is your blind spot today? Which of those people, the disciples, the Pharisees, the neighbors, the parents, who do you think you are most like? Doesn't really matter. Because the opportunity is there again to come to Jesus, to meet with him, to allow him to touch our lives, to believe, and then to see. The world says, "Show me. I want to see and then I believe." The scripture says, "Believe, and then you will see." May that be true for all of us this morning. Let us pray. God, our Father, we're often only too aware of our blindness. So we're so thankful that you reach out your hand to us again. That you're a forgiving Lord. That you touch us and renew us and restore us. And it is our prayer that you would touch each of us where we need to be touched this very day. So that we can believe and give glory to you. Final hymn is very well known, but it does have the wonderful lines, "I was blind, but now I see, amazing grace, how sweet the sound."
Fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.